had a grasp, a firm handle on what was going on around them. They weren't deluded. They weren't caught off guard. They had this prophetic grace on them, even though their tribe was small. The predictive nature of the presence of God that was on them was sufficient to calm the nerves of a nation, because they knew what thus said the Lord. And in this day and time, we need people who are like the sons of Issachar, who understand the times. They're not flustered by things that happen. They're not shocked by anything. I was here last night giving you the 13 points about you know who. And in Canada, they were passing a law so that I can't say things like that. It's the Sharia law that's implementing. It's creeping, but it's there. Islamophobia, you can't say anything that they think is an insult to them. So if I say Jesus is Lord, I've just insulted them. They passed that law yesterday in Canada. So we are going to have to couch the language. And we're going to say what we have to say. We're not going to lie. We're going to say what we have to say. Romans chapter 1 and verse number 20. You have your word? That's Romans 1:20. Oh. For the invisible, that's where you were telling me number 9 and number 10 last night. You're looking at the wall. Eh? For the invisible things of him, that's God. No, don't read too fast. These things are invisible. You can't see it with your natural eye. Of him, God, from the creation, from when time began, when God sliced a piece of time out of eternity, from then, the invisible things of God from the very beginning of the world are clearly seen. Well, hold a minute. You just said it's invisible. How is it clearly seen? Being understood or grasped by the things that are made. So hold a minute. Things that are made, things that are visible, things that you can see, as you see them and understand them and grasp them, the visible things are making a declaration about things that you can't see, about invisible things. If you can understand the visible things, you can get the nature of the invisible things. You can grasp what's happening in the invisible by virtue of what you see and understand through seeing the visible things. Are you getting that? Being understood by things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, even the mysteries of eternity, God's power and the Godhead, the three in one, the one in three, all of that can be understood by things that can be seen, so that they, whoever they are without excuse. You can understand the prophetic nature of God when you grasp the visible things that he shows you time after time. If you are tuned in to your day and time, things that happen in your day and time can be instructive of things that are not seen at all. And we are going to get two examples tonight that has to do with America. One has to do with the presidency of Donald Trump, and one has to do with the game with the Patriots and the... My host is laughing. I saw him dance. I didn't know he had such moves. When the team, obviously he was back in that team when they won. Are you ready to go? 2017 will be a year of divine reversals. Divine reversals, meaning things that went wrong, boom, stop, back to where you were before and higher. God doesn't work just to give back what you got, Job. Exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask or think. Reversals, it's coming. And we need to pray for strategy to move into the season of advancing. Because that's what it is. It looks like you're losing, and all of a sudden you make that big lunge into the future. Accelerated speed of progress. You knew you had nothing to do with it. You could only say, to God be the glory. Number two. Let me give you some scripture there. Deuteronomy 23 and 5. Let a child scream and shout. They are just giving praise to God. Isaiah 65 and 11. A little child shall lead them. Is that right? Let them praise God. Don't take them outside. Genesis 7 and 8. This year, we are going to overcome incredible odds. Incredible odds. I'm going to make the connection later on down in the message. We are going to be returning to a good position after a loss. Esther, Haman, a turnaround season. This year, you're going to receive victory over things that you have struggled with. This is a miracle season. The appointed time, the set time for God to move and have favor in your life has come. You can be destroyed with all this knowledge if you don't know it. Because it's available. My people are destroyed. Why? They don't have a good hallelujah and a lovely drum set. They have all of that stuff. Nice bass. And still they are being destroyed. Cushion pew. And still they are being destroyed. And there are people that are hungry for God. And they have more insight into the things of God in sitting on their hard pew, if they got that. Going to church standing in 3 feet of water. And they're still in church. Because they're hungry for God. You hearing a brother? God has to restore hope to the church in 2017. The world is in a hopeless mess. And if the church doesn't have hope to give to the world is without hope. People already know you can't trust your politicians. 99 of them lie all the time. You didn't say nothing there. Not my party. My party got holy men of God. Yeah, give me the name of that guy who you bought that weed from. That's some good weed you smoking. Your politician is honest. The devil is alive. God has to restore hope to the church so that the church can give hope to the world. This year, some hope will come from unseen places. And it's coming in a hurry. This year marks 500 years of the Reformation. Remember Martin Luther when he nailed the thesis on the door? That period of Reformation was a messy time. Martin Luther had to pay the price for truth to be restored. It was a time of great authority. He had to defeat some formidable opponents. But he had on him an anointing and a disgust. He was ready to overthrow and overcome and get out of that mess. So in some cases, if you want restoration and reformation and the truth to be the thing that the people are going for, you're going to have to be willing to deal with some mess. I didn't get much help there. Christians are people that want victory, but they don't want no fight. You can't win if you didn't fight. You can't win if you didn't run. All those spectators clapping in the Olympics, none of them got gold, silver, nor bronze. Because they're not involved in the race. Even people who are in the race don't get gold, silver, and bronze. You have to run and you have to place first, second, or third. Or two of you tie, four of you can win. It's getting quieter and quieter. That's a good sign. Many empty, dry saints will cry out to God for revival this year. They can't pass 2017. They have had enough. Revolution on many fronts is coming. I'm talking about the church now. Revolution in many fronts. People get just... They will come to that place where they say, that's it. That's it. I'm not taking this another day. All this manipulation going on here, I'm out of this. And they'll be bold enough to tell the powers that be, Tata, amen. The Lord bless you. Amen. Don't call, don't come, don't visit. I'm done with this mess. People getting all quiet right now. You can't tell your church that. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Spectacular evangelistic anointing. Incredible healing anointing. Unbelievable gifts of the Spirit. Accurate prophetic power pointing the way ahead. Relational grace of the apostolic gift will burst forth and they will all merge into one, leading to many national transformations overnight. Many nations will be born again overnight. When I say many nations, I'm talking about nations, but not everybody in the nation, but for the most part, a whole lot of people in that nation that can turn the trajectory of what's happening in that country. These anointings, the apostle, the evangelist, the healing anointing, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the prophetic, predictive, accurate power of God will all merge in 2017. We're going to see the church in its splendor beginning this year. Now understand this, not every prophetic word of God comes to pass because of the laxity and laziness of God's people. The will of God is not always done. God is not willing that any should perish. Do people perish? Every day. Why are they perishing if it's the will of God for them not to perish? So the will of God is not coming to pass when people perish. But God has already done everything in his power to prevent people from perishing. But there is an onus, a responsibility that's left on us to take some things and run with it. To pray some things through. Satan is not just going to sit back and let us get victory after victory after victory. He's going to put up a stiff fight. But we were made for such a time as this. Come on, I'll get excited about the fight. Don't get disturbed and nervous. Yeah. Bless the Lord. The working of creative miracles will explode worldwide. Harvests that are coming in, I'm talking about souls now, in the many millions. The largest stadiums of the nation will not just accommodate football and cricket and all this other soccer stuff, but it will be used to accommodate the church because we don't have the place for the numbers of people that want to hear the real word of God. There's a hunger out there. There's a hunger out there. And we have the bread of life, for God's sake. Slice that bread and let the world get a taste. Or taste and see that the Lord is good. Somebody say yes. Glory to God. Daniel 12:4, John 10:10, Mark 4:22. I'm saying many spectacular miracles will hit the social media. People will be able to capture it and it will go, as the woman said, virus. You got to pray for her. God is going to use every means at his disposal to get the message of the gospel of his son out there. You're going to see things that you can't believe. You think somebody made this up. It's fake news. Listen, church. Many of the cyber troubles that the world is having, God will raise up in the church. You know these cyber nerds? You didn't say nothing. To stop hackers like Vladimir and the rest of them. Yes, the church is going to excel in technology. The church folk. We're not only just going to clap and say hallelujah and come to church and go home. We have the wisdom of God, or don't we have it? Yes, God will use us, people who are in this realm. I'm not talking about me now. And you never know. Because overnight, God can give you understanding in areas you never had before. Prophetic word release or a gift. A gift. People are trained in this thing. And here you come. You had no training at all. And you're outdoing them at their best level. In your sleep, you can outdo them because of a gift from God. The Bible says of a certain guy in the Old Testament, around Deuteronomy there, the Lord gave him wisdom and skill in woodcraft and gold and silver and all kinds of construction. The man was an absolute genius, and all of that came from God. Overnight, he got a download of this ability without going to any school. So God can gift a person in an area and cause them to excel and supersede those who are doing that thing to the best of their ability. I didn't get much amen, but I'm saying my own amen. Yes, yes. Breakthroughs will come in areas where the enemy has assaulted believers. Breakthrough in your health. Breakthrough in your finances. Breakthrough in your relationships with other people. Some believers don't know how to deal with other people. That's why those who are Jamaican, they stay with Jamaicans. Those who are Guyanese, they stay with Guyanese. Those who are from Trinidad, they stay with those from Trinidad. And even when they're in the church, if they go eat, they sit at the table, all them eating together. They can't mix because they're funny with other people. As if their people are the only people who know how to eat or how to whatever. You're going to be a Christian in this day and time. You better get some Chinese friends and some white ones. Get people who are not like you. They don't come from yard. They don't come from your country. Go ye out into what? All the world. Christians are sometimes some of the most biased people in the world. And after country come, they're next. Which church do you go to? You're not from our church, our denomination. They start to get funny again. They always have to suss you out first. Like, what church do you go, Reverend? Well, I go to church. What country are you from? Canada? No, before that. They want to know so they can box you in and put you in this little thing. And then they start to see you through their jaundiced eye. I didn't get much help there. That's all right. We're going to break some stuff that's holding people for years and years and years. And somebody just has to tell them what it is. And they say, whoa, I didn't know that was what that was. I thought I was being deep. No, you're not deep, you're carnal. And the Lord has to break you out of that so that you can appreciate other people. Because when the Indians come, they come in large numbers. And they're coming. I'm saying it again tonight, Brian. Where's my witness? Divine reversals are coming to the church. Yes, yes. I said yes again. I said yes again. New reputation God will give you. Psalm 126 and 4. The voices will be raised in joy and gladness. Jeremiah 33 and 11. I will restore the fortune of the land and make it as it was in the initial stages of its power. I will restore the fortune of the land. Oh, bless his name. The yoke-breaking anointing will be released upon believers, and they will enter into new levels of kingdom encounter, kingdom experience, kingdom authority. 2 Samuel 5, verse 17 to 21, Micah 2 and 13, Psalms 18, verse number 7. Restoration is coming for them that hunger and thirst for it, and then the others will come dragging behind. Somebody has to go up first. May I be alive and alert to experience some of this when God breaks forth and shows the world what he can do. And there will be no secret. Hey, what God can do. Yes. 1 Corinthians 14 and 1, Galatians 5 and 14. All of these things that I said before now are going to operate by love and not by manipulation. These things will work, but the motivation behind doing what you're doing will be pure. You're not out to hustle somebody. It's not a monkey hustle here. These things operate by the love of God. Many times you do favors to people, say, Rev, what's the catch? There's no catch. What do you mean there's no catch? Just get out of my face. There's no catch. Well, everybody else that did it for me did it with a catch. I'm not everybody else. Every time I do a favor for people, I say NSA. What do you mean by NSA? No strings attached. You say thanks. That's all you have to say, thanks. You don't have to thank me again every time you see me. And you don't have to obligate yourself to me. Now you got to come pick me up at the airport every time I come. Now you got to take me to New York if I want. Because remember, last month I gave you a handkerchief. Look, take a dozen handkerchiefs and done with it. I don't have to take you to New York. Some people obligate you to themselves. By doing you a favor. It's manipulation. It's witchcraft. And we're getting out of all of that. Rather not do it than to obligate people and make them feel guilty every time they see you. The devil is a liar and so is his mother-in-law and all of his stepchildren. We're not dealing with that stuff anymore. We are done with it. It's over. You're not going to manipulate me anymore. I'm done with you too. Name of Jesus. I'm freedom, freedom. Freedom for me. Freedom, Lord. The church is going to pick up momentum and shift into full-scale destiny pace. Every other organization is moving at 2017 speed except the church. We're still in 1963. Still got the old miserable songs we sing, the old miserable clothes, miserable mentality, miserable, just not progressive. Boring. Church folks are boring people. Not y'all, we are kingdom people. I said church folk. I got to make a distinction. Church folk go to church, sing what they got, they do their normal duty out of obligation. But kingdom people, they are on the cutting edge. They are on the cusp of the wave. They want to see what God is doing and be a part of what God is doing. Say yes, yes. Say that's me. Say, Reverend, you're talking my name. Yes. It's going to be a year of refreshing, where we will see young boys and girls with the wisdom of the aged. They are 10 and 12 going on 50. Now I'm talking literally now. We will have young people in our midst with the wisdom of an old person. They are 10 going on 75. Somebody's sure you look at them like, they came here before. No, they now come. But they have come with extra. Are you hearing me, brother? I've got 2-3-year-olds that borrow my phone and do stuff on that phone. I don't even know where they find the stuff from. All kinds of games and stuff. And they say, yeah, Pastor, I have to give them the phone to do their thing. How do they know that? They just came here the other day. You were sucking breasts and stuff. What do you know about smartphone? They know. And they'll help you too. Where does that wisdom come from? They came with it. They came ready to do big stuff for the glory of God. Hey, yes, 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 yes. This is a year of mustering the troops. Listen to me carefully. This is a year where God is mustering the troops. He's bringing them together, picking one here, picking one there, picking two there. Mustering the troops. Are you there still? It's a year of preparation and positioning. He's gathering, he's preparing, and placing them. Why? Because at some point in time, he will say, Mark. And when he does say that, we're not breaking ranks and we're not stopping until the trumpet sounds and the dead are raised. That's what it's going to be. So we will notice people that we haven't seen before, haven't known before, suddenly becoming a part of churches that, oh, I never thought that person would ever be a Christian. God is preparing. God is positioning his people. I rebuke that distraction in the name of Jesus. Get out of here. Get out of here. Get out of here in Jesus' name. You know, none of the prophets ever had a demon come fight them except Daniel. And it was in regard to a prophetic word that he had gotten from God. He didn't understand what he was saying. And this demon wouldn't let the angel pass to give him understanding. Whenever prophetic words are going to be released, satanic opposition will rise up at a height. He is afraid of you knowing what tomorrow will bring, because when you know, you're more stable as a believer. Hey. Yes. A year when those who have got the wounds of war will also get the spoils of war. This year, 2017. Those of us, I'm putting myself right up there, who have endured the wounds of the Christian war, we'll not only show the scars of the war, but we'll also have the spoils of the war. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. This year I got two of the biggest checks I ever got. I just put them aside, didn't touch them yet. I'm a happy camper. You notice I put the phone because people see this and think now tomorrow they start to say, Reverend, you know, my child got to go to the exam and they don't have fees. And hey, Brother Isaac, I got one of those today. I was surprised. And, whoa. He told me, look, this thing is a, aye. Anyway, you got to be so careful in this kingdom. Yes, let me say it again slowly. This is a year when those who have gotten the wounds of war will also get the spoils of war. The spoils, the blessings, the things that you work hard for and didn't get then, but you're going to get it now. People leave you in their will just because they like you. You're a total stranger. Look, I'm making my will. I'm putting Pastor Cameron's name in there. What are you talking about? You don't know him? Yes, he's doing a good job there. Boom, put his name there. The house on the hill, that's his. Somebody looks at that, will never happen. It wouldn't happen to you, but it's going to happen to me. Those who say it can't be done and those who say it can be done, they are both right. Oh, I can feel it coming now. Yes, this will be a year of confronting every satanic ruling that is illegal in the lives of God's people and in the church. Yes, this is the year to confront the demonic powers that have established themselves and have a sense of entitlement, and they will not budge, but they are not supposed to be there. And some of us have seen them long enough to recognize them, and we're going to tell them, devil, back off in Jesus' name. Yeah. Confrontation is coming. People who were mousy before, the mouses shall roar. The mice shall roar. Shall roar, I said, yes. They're going to have an attitude that you will be shocked. They say, whoa, I thought you were nice and easy. I am nice and easy. But for this demonic thing here, I've got to have a totally different mindset. I've got to get into beast mode to deal with this thing in the name of Jesus. This is a year when knowledgeable saints will establish and protect their jurisdiction. They will establish their jurisdiction and protect it. All of us are anointed for a particular geographic location. Amen. I'm going to take my time with this one. No, I was skimming the fat today. Lord said, when you meet to this, you slow down. So I'm slowing down now, but I'm still going to go at I'm not crawling up in here. This is point number 14, 15. There you go. Somebody's keeping tabs on a brother. Name of Jesus. Yes. This is a year where you come into the full understanding of atmospheres and spheres. Atmospheres and spheres. Jurisdiction. The area of your authority. Who you are in Christ and knowing what you can deal with and what you can't handle right now. You need two other friends to come with you to deal with that kind of stuff. Are you paying attention? You with your little gentle Jesus, meek and mild, you better buckle up and learn fast. Too many lazy Christians in the church. Mentally lazy. Don't want to do Bible study. and they want to grow and become a sensation for God. You can't live like a blunder and become a wonder. You're not going to blunder into greatness. It doesn't happen like that. You got to put some time in there. I'm leaving this one. Some people caught that right away. Okay, Lord. Listen, brethren. Atmospheres produce tangible results. Certain atmospheres produce tangible results. I can preach here tonight and get minuscule results. Preach another place, minuscule results. Preach another place, and they think I'm the best thing since sliced bread. I go to the British Virgin Islands, people come to the airport. They come and get me off the plane. Somebody's carrying my bag like I can't carry my own bag. There are people at the airport waiting for prayer. They think that if they get the first prayer, that's the rich anointing. And as the anointing, you know, as it subsides, those who get the second prayer get a weaker thing. Hey, you know, like God gets weary. God is not weary. His power is exhaustless. You can't tire him out. Your body can get tired, but not the power of God. In fact, when I am weak, then am I strong. Oh, glory to God. Certain atmospheres will produce tangible results. Atmospheres can unlock spiritual principles, spiritual presences, and breakthroughs. Certain atmospheres can unlock spiritual principles. You can grasp things in a certain place that you can't grasp in another place. The presences, presence of God, presence of the Holy Spirit, presence of Jesus, presence of angels, presence of saints who have gone on before. We're not talking demons now. Not everything is Satan and Baku and Jumbi and Duppy. I spent the entire 2014, most of it in the book of Daniel. And after a while, this thing would come into the room. I rebuked the devil the first time. The Lord said, it's not the devil. Okay. But it's not you either, Lord. No. Well, who is it that dares come into my room? You're going to figure that one out for yourself. I was so into Daniel that the grace, the prophetic grace that was flowing through his book, proximity, absorption, we talked about it last night. That thing was coming on, and I was understanding scripture that I had read for years. And suddenly, boom, whoa, I had to snatch my pen and write quick as the revelation hit. You say, oh, that can't happen. Well, Jesus was on the Mount of Transfiguration. Moses and Elijah appeared. Yeah, I'm giving you biblical stuff now to back up what I'm saying. When Jesus died and after his resurrection, the dead bodies of the saints were seen walking all around Jerusalem. We are encompassed about by so great a cloud of witnesses. I'll already give you three witnesses. I'm done with that. Atmospheres can unlock spiritual principles, presences, and breakthroughs. Your life can change by shifting the atmosphere around you, and you have the ability to do it. Now, pay attention. Pay attention. Listen, don't let anything distract you. Are you there? Your life can change by shifting the atmospheres around you and the spheres around you because you are a climatological Christian. You are a climatological Christian. You can change and decide climate. The climate doesn't decide you. You decide it. Bugsy Siegel and them other criminals back in American history went down to Las Vegas, Nevada. It was a desert. They started to put up the Flamingo Hotel, the Sands Hotel. These guys started to build massive hotels in the desert. And after a while, people started coming to gamble, coming from all over the world. These bandits had changed the atmosphere of a desert without the presence of God, without the anointing, without Ukum and Shandai kicking him on the shin. Billions and billions passed through Las Vegas because of Bugsy Siegel, a gangster. But he went there and changed the whole environment without the anointing. If he can do that without the anointing, what are we afraid of? I'm walking in all timid like you can, my chance. The devil is a liar. I'm going to stomp on the elephant's head too. Are you hearing me, brother? You are a climate changer. When you go there, the atmosphere doesn't determine you. They're upset, so you're upset. They're mad, so you're mad. They're vexed, so no, you get there. If they were mad when you got there, they have to start smiling because you are changing the whole place. Your presence alone. You don't even have to say anything. There's something that's jumping off of you that's exuding the joy of the Lord. And before long, they start smiling. Oh, sister is here. Oh, it's going to be a good day. Of course it is. I got it like that. You're not being arrogant. It's just what it is. You carry the presence of God. You are a carrier of the power of Jehovah. Oh, glory to his name. Don't you let the atmosphere determine you. Everybody cussing you upset. No, you smile, sing. Listen carefully. Your life can change by shifting atmospheres and spheres around you. You're a climatological Christian. In Genesis 1, the formless void and darkness was hovered over and brooded over by the power of the Holy Spirit. He was massaging the environment, and out of that formless void and darkness covering the face of the deep, there came order A, hello, creativity B, and tangible results. Suddenly there was order where there was chaos. Everything came to its right place. The water receded and subsided. Dry land appeared. Things started to be where they were supposed to be because the Holy Spirit was hovering over the mess. Pay attention, pay attention. Pay attention. Don't lose this. You can create your atmosphere and sustain it. Maintain it. You're not supposed to be anointed today and tomorrow you got no power. What's up with you? God is not a yo-yo. Hey. I'm the Lord. I change not. We are the ones who change. And then our behavior drives and grieves the Holy Spirit. Are you still paying attention? Are you still paying attention? Yes. Listen carefully. Control your sphere of influence. Whatever jurisdiction the Lord has given you, you control that. You got authority, take authority. Pay attention still. You can create and sustain your environment, control your sphere of influence, and allow no one to usurp your authority, not even jokingly. It takes a while to build the relationship with God and to have things flowing. Don't let anybody mess it up. Are you there? All right. Sights and sounds control your atmosphere. Sights, what you see. Sounds, what you hear, control your atmosphere. So if you want to change your atmosphere, you have to change what you see and what you hear. No, the TV don't have to be on all the time. No, it's not breaking news, Wolf Blitzer. That was this morning news. You just say it 50 times all day. We fed up with you. It's not news. It's not breaking news. It's old. It's stale news. It was on this morning. We know that. They didn't get the votes and they pulled the thing. We know that. What else? News means new, something new. Different. Not the same old thing said in different ways, bringing all these experts. We're tired of that. If you're going to create your atmosphere and shift your environment, you must change what you see. You must change what you hear. So you now determine, all right, Miles is dead, but I liked his ministry. I'm going to get some of his DVD. I'm going to see that. I'm going to hear that. What are you doing? You're shifting the atmosphere around you. You got some good gospel worship people that know God and love God. We're not talking Kirk Franklin now. You put people that make sense and want to go somewhere with God. Yeah, that's upset a lot of people. I got to preach and I got to upset you at least one time. And so you put in the right people who bring the presence of God when they sing. Certain people will not appeal to you. Don't bother to listen to them. Some people will appeal to you. Listen to that. You don't like African music? Okay, get some Indian music. Get some other stuff that is in sync with your personality and who you are. You're not going to like everybody, but you're going to like somebody. You can't be a hater. You hate everything. We got to rebuke and cast that demon out of you now. And so you find a thing that is in sync with your personality type, and you listen to that. After a while, you may get fed up with that. You want something else. That's all right. You have to be selective in what comes in your ear gate and what comes through your eye gate, because it determines the atmosphere that's around you, and atmosphere determines your success. There's a certain environment that's draining, and it doesn't give anything back to you. Get away from that. And there are other environments that excite you and get you go. Oh, whoa, I want some more of that. Yes, Lord. Stay with that. Elisha, stay with Elijah. Never mind the 50 prophets who were sons of the prophets in the school with Elijah. Didn't have enough sense to follow the man all the way. They just wanted his revelation so they could sound deep. But they didn't want to walk with him through Jordan. I'm going to leave that alone. We did that last night. Are you ready for some more? Where was I before I truly interrupted? Yeah, somebody's listening. Control your atmosphere and sphere, the region where you have governing authority. Are you there, church? Yeah. Your set place of influence. Rid it of anything that's negative and polluting. What goes into the eyes and ears affect your atmosphere. A contaminated atmosphere now, it binds and shuts down creativity. Listen to me carefully. A contaminated atmosphere binds and shuts down creativity. All right? Let's go back to Genesis 1. In the beginning, God, what's the next word there? Eh? The first thing you notice about God is his ability at creativity. That's the first thing You notice about in the beginning God, he exists, created. All right, where am I going with that? I'm glad you asked. If the first thing God did was creative, you wouldn't get the second thing God did without the first thing being done. You can't go to number 3, 4, 5, 6 if you didn't get number 1. If your atmosphere is contaminated, you can't be creative. If you're not creative, that's number 1. Nothing else will happen. Creativity is key to the flow. You have to have the river first before you have the flow. Some of us have no flow because we got no river, because our atmosphere is contaminated. You can't watch X-rated movie one time, you listen to Sinak the next time. What kind of schizophrenic Christians do we have today? Cussing one moment, they're deep in the anointing, they're Ukumana Shandai speaking in tongues. No, this no sankina. That's right, they're not singing song. You cannot be all over the place. You have to control your atmosphere. Watch it. Certain people, when they come around you, they get into all kinds of wicked conversation. Avoid them like AIDS. They are dangerous to your spiritual growth. You're not being bigoted and you're fussy. Yes, sir, I'm fussy. Salvation is free, but this power of God, it takes a while for it to grow. And once you get it, you better maintain it. Don't allow anybody to get that away from you. Say yes, yes. Glory to God. I said glory to God. I said glory to God. I said glory to God. Yes, a contaminated atmosphere binds up and shuts down creativity. God's first action was creativity. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. If you can't do first, you're not going to be able to do anything, because first comes before second, third, and fifth. If first is shut down by a contaminated atmosphere, everything else is shut down. Contamination hinders progress. Are you there? I said contamination hinders progress. It constrains and confines and caps you and holds you back. It blocks you. It gives you marginal success and minuscule progress. It caps you. It puts a cap on top. A contaminated atmosphere caps you. All of that nice stuff that's in there can't come out to bless anybody because you're capped because of contamination. You can turn the thing upside down. In this position, gravity is supposed to make it run, but nothing is going anywhere because of contamination. It's not a little thing. It's not a small thing. What the Pope did in Guyana has contaminated all of the churches. You got teachers running pornographic rings in Guyana right now. Teachers doing that in the school with a little 11-year-old girl. And their rationale is, if the Pope can do it, then anybody can do it. Contaminate the whole nation. The deceased did that. Look, man. Contaminated atmosphere binds up, shuts down creativity, pollutes it, hinders progress. A pure atmosphere, on the other hand, releases power, miracles, and breakthrough. In a good, clean atmosphere, things are birthed. Things are stirred. Things are released. Things are deposited. Birthed. Stirred up. Released. Deposited. My God, man. You're not seeing fresh things happening because nothing is birthed. The atmosphere is contaminated. You can't function in that. Even in today's world, they have these things. You go, you squeeze and rub your hand because of what? Yeah, they're trying to get rid of that. The world is picking up on things the church should pick up on. That visible evidence that the world is showing us with that stuff that you wipe your hands with and you smell that alcohol and it gets a little cold in your hand. What is that visible thing telling us? Yes, you need to clean up and constantly. Even the banks have it, all the money, all the drugs. You don't know where that money went. They're constantly sanitizing. You're a Christian, you sanitize once a week. I'm going to leave that alone, eh? In a good, clean atmosphere, things are birthed, stirred, released, deposited in the atmosphere. Jesus in Mark 5 put out some people, said, no, I want Peter, James, and John. He had 12 disciples. I want Peter, James, and John, and all y'all and your family, all y'all get out of the house. Because this dead girl will come back to life, but this atmosphere is too for me to work. The mighty Jesus had to get rid of some people in order for something to happen. got rid of some of his disciples too. 9 of them got those jokers out of the room. Everybody can't be wrong when certain things happen. They can't handle it. They contaminate it. They shut it down. Oh, Pastor, you got favorites? Of course. I can't pour into John what I pour into Judas. It's getting quieter and quieter. Hey. Lord Jesus, have mercy on us here. Eh? Before he raised Jairus' daughter, Peter, James, and John, before resurrection power hit, he cleaned the house. Jesus cleaned the house and set us an example. Certain things happen in a clean house that don't happen in the other house. Yeah. He shifted the atmosphere. Why? By getting rid of the people, because association contaminates as well. Iron sharpens iron and iron rusts iron. Some people are not good for you. I'm talking Christian people now. Some ministries are not good for you. I'm talking about some preachers are not good for you. Some apostles are not good for you. Some prophets and bishops are not good for you. That deceased man, I tell you. Look at the time when he's doing his stuff. Just when the country is finding all the wealth. You think it's not the demonic strategy? Because the country can become a gateway to all kinds of blessing. That's what God is trying to do. And one of his so-called persons supposed to be on God's side. Mess the whole plan. Now we need some people of rank carrying Christian authority to go speak nationally to, first of all, apologize to the sinners for the worthless, low-down, classless behavior of the Rev. And then pronounce judgment on the Rev and call him the deceased so that he will go faster. And then when people see God kill him off fast, they will fear the Lord. And things will get back to normal. You can't allow something like this to just go down the tubes like that. Somebody has to address the thing nationally. I'm not getting no help right now. All right. Yes, sir. We can do spiritual house cleaning. We can do spiritual housekeeping. It's our responsibility. Every time I come down here, I see some ladies there. They're moving stuff. The place clean already. But they're still cleaning. They're still moving. They're still wiping. What are they doing? House cleaning, housekeeping. You go to Brother Isaac's house, you don't know people live there. Everything is in place. I'm thinking my house is a real, like, tornado pass through there. But I got young men, and you understand, it's a different. I got my wife, got children that, in her daycare, they just throw everything all over the place. But you can tell somebody's keeping house. Yeah? That's just a house. You're a spirit man that's supposed to house God, you don't keep it like that. You thought I was just talking about house cleaning. I got a trick up my sleeve. You got to keep this house clean. This temple, this body is the temple of God. Hey! And when we clean it, then the atmosphere is right. So get you your good music. Disassociate yourself from certain people until you're strong enough to handle their mess without getting contaminated. You know, there comes a point in your Christian life where after a while, you become uncursable. It doesn't matter what they do or say, you just smile. But before that, you got to go home and pray and plead the blood of Jesus and wash yourself in the blood. And your mind is all messed up. You feel a certain way. You want to tell them off. But after a while, when you have been beaten enough and kicked enough and spit on enough, after a while you say, all right, devil, hit me with your best shot. That's all you got. Hit me again. And you walk away bruised. But you know, and he knows too, that after that, George Foreman said, I beat Ali. I punched him so hard, my hands ached. I felt vibrations in my hand. I couldn't hit him. Broke his jaw. And when George did that, Ali leaned over his ear and said, George, my grandmother hits harder than that. George said, I backed up and I look in his eye. And as I look in his eye, I wondered, what else can I do to defeat this man? And with that, he dropped his head. And when he dropped his head, boom, shaka-laka-laka. Good night, Irene. He was flat on his bumper and did not get back up. One right hand lead straight on his noggin because the man had become unbeatable at that point. It destroyed his morale to hit a man with it. George was known to jab men and knock them out with a jab. Hit Ali with his best shot. Now he said, my grandmother. I would like to meet that lady. Man sounds to be bad, but woman sounds to be more than bad. I'm shifting now. You understand how to shift atmosphere? How to clean up the spot so that things can happen. Are you getting that? No, you're not getting that. You think this is entertainment, so you're just kidding. No, you didn't get that. No, you didn't get that. I got to say, no, you didn't get that, so that you will get that. There's a method to my madness. Are we ready to go again? I'm shifting now. Cuba will be receiving a mighty visitation from the Lord in this 2017 and will raise up extraordinary evangelists that will preach across the Caribbean and the world with mighty signs and wonders followed in Cuba. All that pressure that Castro was putting on them, it was for a reason. And now is the season for the reason to be displayed to the world. You can't bribe them with anything. What are you going to bribe them with? They don't care about stuff like that. They want things of eternal value. They've seen it all. They've been there all. They've had enough pressure to last them 10 lifetimes. And they rise up now and say, okay, I want El Señor. He's the one I want. The greatest treasure, the greatest find. Man's greatest find of archaeology. Jesus. They're coming to the world. En el nombre de Jesucristo. You're going to see it happen. Cubans are coming. Bad to the bone. Preaching with thunder and lightning and signs and wonders following them. Are you hearing, brother? Amen. Revival will hit Cuba like a tidal wave. Even Castro's brother will go back to the Catholic Church. All is coming. I said it. Raul Castro is going back to Catholic Church. That was the church that raised him and Fidel in the first place. He's going to go back to his roots. I said, that can't happen. It's going to happen in front of you. You're going to live to see it. Amen. On that day, you say, oh, that you remember that guy? Reverend Cameron brought him there. Yeah, he said that. I didn't believe him then. The Western nations will be hit by a flesh-eating disease, including this one and the one I come from. Flesh-eating. You're allowing the Jews to have people burn them at stakes and burn them in stuff, and you're not standing up for them. When God deals with the church, he deals in grace. When he deals with the Jew, he deals an eye for an eye. Every nation that has given them a hard time and caused them to have their flesh eaten off by those, you know who I'm talking about, is going to hit. Repercussions are coming. Negative repercussions. You just heard it. I'm saying it again. The Western nation. Google who the Western nations are. Every last one of them will be hit by a flesh eating disease. This guy is crazy. I just said it twice. That's a verily, verily. Syria. Bashar al-Assad, Syria. Are you hearing, brother? Yes. Syria will be visited by God in an extraordinary way. And many of those who are now Muslims will come to Christ in Jesus' name. Hebrews 2 and 4, where sin abounds, grace does much the more abound. We are going to see much grace on Syria, the likes of which will make the ears of the world tingle when they hear how many millions of Muslims are coming to Christ. Syria will be visited by God in an extraordinary way. Write that down. Put that in the bank. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. New inventions are coming. New discoveries are coming. Breakthroughs in knowledge is coming. Wisdom and understanding that will bring cures is coming. New inventions are coming. Technological solutions are coming. Advancement is coming. Proverbs 8 and 12. Now listen to me carefully and listen to me well. Cancer will be cured in the next 2 years. I said it. They'll find a cure for cancer in the next 2 years. Oh, no, Rev, you're just blowing hot air. I just said it. Cancer, they'll find a cure for it in 2 years. And the cure will be so simple, people wonder, how come we didn't think of this before? A cure for cancer is coming, thus said the Lord. Are you hearing a brother? Yes. Where was I before I was rudely interrupted? Yes, Iran. Iran will annex parts of three nations. You know what annexation is, right? Like how Venezuela wants to annex the whole of Esseboom. And all the oil that we keep finding every time we dig. Iran will annex parts of three nations and become a major threat to Israel and her neighbors, Iran. As soon as they're done with their weapons of mass destruction and their nuclear bombs that they are building right now or buying from Cuba, Iran will attack Saudi Arabia and win a war against her. Iran, yeah, I know they're both Muslim nations. Iran will attack Saudi Arabia and put a whipping on the Saudis, the likes of which they have not seen. The Saudis will be like the Jews, running to every part of the globe. Some coming wealthy, some coming broke. That nation will be so decimated, it is as if it never existed before. Thus saith the Lord. Yes, are you ready for more? Hezbollah and Hamas. You know who that is? Hezbollah and Hamas. I'm talking 2017 when I'm dealing with this one here. Hezbollah and Hamas will go to war with Israel using other nations as their base. Jordan and Syria will be two of them that they will use. And Israel will utterly defeat both Hamas and Hezbollah to the degree where very few of their soldiers are left. This year is going to happen. Israel is going to war in 2017. You can't say that. Netanyahu doesn't know that. I just did. Thus said the Lord, Israel, you're going to war in 2017 with Hezbollah and Hamas. Thus said Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach. India, massive national revival. And India, like Cuba, will release. In fact, India will be exporting evangelists to the world. We're not talking evangelists coming for an offering. We're talking to evangelists coming with signs, wonders, and miracles. And an interpreter. What are you going to do when a preacher is wearing a dhoti and preaching at you? Oh, I can't stand their clothes and, you know, the curry. And you're going to have to stand a lot of things you can't stand right now. Get ready. I'm trying to get your mind to change, but you think I'm joking. You're looking at me funny like, he ain't no prophet. What is it? I may not be in the office of a prophet, but I got more prophetic understanding and grasp than people that call themselves prophets. And I'm not saying that boastfully. That's just what it is. That's just how it is. You can't spend time with Daniel for 2 years and not get some prophetic thing on you. Proximity absorption. Yes. Jerusalem will become the focus of many nations. Not merely Israel. Jerusalem will be the centerpiece of all kinds of calamity that will hit the world. Jerusalem. You all made a very terrible mistake last year by allowing them to pass the deal to divide Jerusalem. Your country did that by not using the veto power. You ain't saying nothing now. And you know all them scriptures that talk about blessing Abraham and cursing Abraham. And you may not believe this, but if it wasn't for Donald, 3 major earthquakes would have hit this nation and decimate the place. Change the very geography of your country. That was how vengeful the Lord was against a nation that was raised up, running from England to come here to find religious power. The only country that was born almost as similar to what Israel was born. And you have the nerve to just drop them like a hot potato. I asked the Lord about it. Said, well, what's going to happen? He said, I'm storing up wrath for the day of wrath. Said, what are you talking about? He said, the wrath that they're supposed to get, they think they're not going to get it? No. I'm saving it up. And when that day of wrath comes, all the wrath they're supposed to get now and the wrath that they're adding up to get then, when the cup of the Amorites is full, when I deal with them, all the world will look in awe. You got some very terrible days ahead of you. This nation. You know, if the church would only pray, but you can't get Christians to pray. You can't get them to pray. They got a job. Nobody has got a job but Christians. Sinners will do all they have to do and come down to Toronto for Caribana. And Christians, they barely, you know, move a piece of paper off the floor and they're tired for the rest of the week. They did their share of work at LHMI. Nations will get a visit from Jehovah Gibor. Y'all know what that means. In the form of floods, fires, storms, earthquakes, tornadoes, and massive volcanoes. These volcanoes, when they hit, will create forest fires that will destroy acres of trees and spoil the water supply because of actions against the Jew, and particularly actions against Jerusalem. Let me say again, when God deals with the church, he deals with grace. When he deals with Israel, it's an eye for an eye. Zechariah 12 and 2. Jerusalem will be the issue of the future, not terrorists and terrorism. Jerusalem will be the major issue. And when I say future, I'm talking 2017 and going on. Because Israel will go to war this year. Massive volcanoes are coming, the likes of which the world has not seen. Earthquakes that the seismic guys and their seismographs can't measure because they go up to 10. These will be above 10 on the Richter scale. Listen to me carefully, and you're going to see it in your lifetime. The shape, S-H-A-P-E, of this country is going to change. The shape of it will change. Well, they changed the shape of Israel, allowing them to take eastern Jerusalem. It's tit for tat where God is concerned. That is stored up for the day of wrath. This land, said God, shall not be sold forever, for the land is mine, and ye are strangers and sojourners with me. He's talking about the land of Israel. In dealing with Jerusalem, retribution will be prophetic and predictable. Leviticus 25 and 33. In dealing with Jerusalem, retribution will be prophetic and predictable. You know it's going to happen. It's just a matter of when. And as long as Trump is there saying, I'm a friend of Israel, I'm not saying he's a friend of Israel, because every U.S. president has tried to make peace with Israel because they want to leave that legacy as the man who made peace when nobody else could make peace. And he sees himself as the wheeler and dealer, the art of the deal. He is going to try to solve that problem. His ego is too big to not try. His business genius is too extraordinary for him to not attempt. And if he does, he's going to get himself in trouble. As long as he stays on Israel's side, this nation is safe. The day he gets high on his horse and decides he's going to make a deal with Hamas and Hezbollah and the Arabs and Muslim Brotherhood and all that stuff and leave Israel high and dry, that's the day. That day, get your passport, get a ticket, and fly back to your yard. For thus said the Lord, within a week after such a transaction shall judgment fall on America, the likes of which you have not seen. That week, when they do that, that week. I'm talking about 7-day week, not you know, the extraordinary days with God as a 1,000 years. That's not what I'm talking about. Pay attention. Don't let sleep get you. Hey! Amen. Russia and China. Russia and China will continue to annex territory. And at the end of the day, listen carefully, Russia will be on the side of Islam at the end of the day. No matter how they jump and bend and duck and carry on, at the end of the day, Russia will be on the side with Islam. You're not going to like this one. Brace yourself. Are you sitting down? Are you sitting down good?
Yes.
Russia will attack America. Not American interests. Russia will attack Russia will attack the mainland, the homeland of the United States of America. As to whether Putin will do it, didn't see who, but I know it's coming. Russia will attack America. It may not be during the presidency of the Donald, but I can't say for certain that it won't. But what I do know for certain, Russia will attack America. And y'all don't want to know who will lose. So I'm going to leave it there. All this thing about we are the mightiest, this and that, you're going to be very disappointed to find out that you're number two. And if China gets its way, you might be number three. You see how quiet it got? Christians love to say, preach the truth, Rev. Preach. Where you hit truth, start hitting them. They say, oh, no, 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 no. Russia and China will continue to annex territory around the world. Russia will attack America on its mainland. Not the interests, not St. Thomas, America, America. You paying attention? All right, let's get off of that and make you breathe a little easier. This is breathing time. Psalm 68 and 11, the Lord give the word and great is the company of them that publish it. This is the word of the Lord to the women. Are you lazy listening? Listen good. Your identity is not found but in anything else but in Christ. Those who have misjudged you shall come with apologies. Your time to arise and publish the gospel of the kingdom has come. Are you listening to our brother? There are going to be three levels of anointing that will hit women this year, 2017. Are you listening? There are three levels of anointing that is coming on women this year to activate them and get them busy in the things of God. The men are failing like nothing. If the men keep failing at the rate they're failing, you need the women to step up to the plate. God called you to help the man, didn't he? Well, help the brothers out. The anointing of a great intercessor. Your role as priests has come to maturity. You will be used to pray through to breakthrough. The anointing of a prophetic intercessor. You will see and hear the future and prepare the church to go there. I'm talking to the women, specifically the women. Men, this is not for you. All you need to know that this is going to happen and align yourself so when your wife starts seeing and hearing things, you don't think she's gone off cuckoo caca. The anointing of a prophetic intercessor is coming on women, giving them the ability to pray through to breakthrough. The anointing of a prophetic intercessor. You will see things and hear things that pertain to the future, and you'll be able to announce them to the church or prepare the church to go there. Number two, the anointing of a prophetic warrior. It's come. This prophetic intercessor like Anna, the prophetic warrior like Miriam. You will take worship to a realm of the angelic. You will be catalyst. You will be kerosene. You will be gas to ignite a level of worship the likes of which the church had never seen. Worship sessions with women will see supernatural healings and new births take place without sweat and without manipulation. Number three, the anointing of a prophetic dancer, Deborah. Yes, what the men don't want to touch, you will be able to touch. What the men didn't want to do, Deborah, will come and do it. Territories which men are afraid to enter. Women will go and open the doors for the spies to come, that the men can come and partake of. Are you there? Nerves of steel they will develop for war. Attitudes of a general. We're going to have women with the attitude of a general. They are strategic. They are tough-minded. They are no nonsense. They're not giggling with anybody. They're not messing around. They don't want nobody's husband. They just want to see God's work done. The spirit of warfare is on them. Jehovah Gibor, I say, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. For those women who no one has thought of giving you a ministry until now, no one has thought of being a blessing to you until now, your anointing will be more glorious than the women of the past. Shout yes. Yes. Glory to God. Yes. Let me get back to America now that I got you shouting. This is good though. Detroit, Michigan. Detroit, you know what I'm talking about. Detroit will see a resurgence in the auto industry. The foundation is already there. They didn't have to dig foundation for September 11th. The building was gone, but the foundation was there. The foundation for the auto industry, the framework to set it up. The buildings, some of them are there. Some of them are destroyed, but the foundation is there. So it wouldn't take much to activate it and get it going. Are you hearing a brother? Yes. There will be a resurgence of the auto industry in America, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. The steel industry will see revival and restoration and a rebirth. Suddenly things will explode and thrive. Yes, yes, thus said the Lord. Bridges, buildings, roads, and factories will be restored to their former beauty. Thus said the Lord. Property in Detroit will see the value explode. So if you're a good real estate person, get your home office in Detroit and start buying up property. Because when this blessing hits, you want to be there to be able to sell at a high rate of interest. A sinner will see this and start buying up property in Detroit. A Christian will hear this and just scratch themselves and forget about it. Christians are the most unbusiness-like, unprogressive people on the planet. I'm just saying this to get you angry. So you say, not me, you're not talking to me. You should know my strategy by now. I got to get you vexed to take action. Because our people, unless they get vexed, they don't do nothing. But if and when they get vexed, when they get mad, when a black person gets prickled, you better run. I don't care male or female, it doesn't matter. They will tear up a train and throw it away with their teeth and come after you. Oh, Jesus, have mercy. Yes, yes. Women arising in the schools. I'm back to women now, and teachers, to block Jezebel's attempt to get the next generation, to instill the morals and values of kingdom agenda. Don't be quiet when you're in the school. Don't stay silent. Open your mouth and give the winds a mighty voice. The devil is after the next generation in the schools, and we need some Christian teachers in the school that will stand in the gap and don't move because Jezebel is looking for the next generation, and you must be there to block her and to project and promote the kingdom of God. Shout yes, yes. I didn't say yes, yes. Shout yes, yes. Yes, yes. There is power in obedience. If I say shout yes, shout. Don't say yes. Just obey. You never know what blessing God can hit you with. And the more the church is obeying, when I give them small things to do, if they obey, the anointing builds. If they disobey, I get angry. Like they don't know what they don't know who's preaching at them here. They think I just come to play, mess around and make jokes here. Just come for a free ride, wasting the church's money, buying me ticket. I'm not just here to say something. I got something to say. So as simple as an instruction is, just obey it. You never know. You never know. That's a good yarn right there. Many women will be awake to do business in the marketplace. The spirit of entrepreneurship will hit them. And you're going to see them do business, do deep multi-million dollar businesses. Women in the kingdom will do that. Now listen, politicians can't handle the satanic attack. You know the devil knows his time is short and has come down with great wrath. If the devil is giving you the kind of trouble he's giving you, then the sinner man who doesn't know God, he can't stand up. Are you paying attention now? Your politicians cannot handle the satanic attacks. It needs apostolic warfare with intensity. Satan knows his time is short. We need some trained warriors who will undergird their politicians who can, so that they can handle the satanic pressure. We need people with prophetic insight needed to pray in the spirit when necessary. Lift up your heads, all ye gates, Psalm 24:8-9. And be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and let the King of glory come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, mighty in battle. He is the King of glory. We need the Lord to invade our political system because those guys are fighting with things they don't know what they're dealing with, and they can't handle it. They don't have the covering you have, the protection you have, the blood of Jesus you have. Isaiah 8:18, children will rise up with old men's wisdom. I and the children whom the Lord had given me are for signs and wonders in Israel, said the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth in Zion. The children that the Lord has given us are for signs and wonders. Amen. There'll be a different breed of children coming up in the land in Jesus' glorious name. Where does the time go? There will be a spirit of unity that will come in the church. Streams of God's people that never flowed with each other before shall begin to flow together in 2017. There's going to be major reconciliations in the church. And the sign is Trump. The Donald. Sign of reconciliation. Didn't he say he will protect Israel? Didn't he say he will stand with Israel? After the fiasco when they were left out hanging the coal and nobody would sign when they should have, could have signed to protect them from Eastern and Western Jerusalem being divided. It's a sign of reconciliation. I'm back to Romans 1:20. The invisible things of God are seen by the things that are. You are looking at the fact that you don't like Donald. And so you can't receive from God because you don't like him. But you got to look past that. That's what I'm saying. Your mind has got to change. God will use people you don't like. Cubans come in here talking about Jesus. You want to know what they don't know about Jesus. They know about Fidel. They know about communism. What do Indians know about roti and curry? That's what some people's mindset tells them. But it's a different breed coming. And your mind has to open for you to be able to handle what your parachute has to open up so that you can come down at the right rate of speed. Are you hearing me, brother? If your mind is closed, you coming down fast, you're going to hit yourself and hurt yourself and crash and die. Hey-ho! Glory a Dios, man. Yes, yeah. Yes, sir. I got a good amen there. Yes. The spirit of unity, I was saying. Indiana, remember that state? The crossroads of America is a nickname given to the state of Indiana. Are you there? More specifically, the city of Indianapolis is the hub for several major interstate highways that crisscross the state, connecting the Hoosier state to the rest of the United States. This official state motto of Indiana was designated to it, given to it in 1937. Yes, I did my homework. The crossroads state. That's where Trump got his vice president from the crossroads. Are you getting the message now? Are you making the connection now? Your country is at the crossroads. When Pharaoh was ruling, Pharaoh was as wicked as they come, and the guy that interpreted the dream was as righteous as they come. And he gave the righteous guy to become his right hand. You making the connection? Here's this guy who's all of that and some more. And he picks this guy up from the crossroads states, supposedly a righteous man, and makes him his second in command. Are you making the connection now? Come on, y'all. Some people still have that blank stare on their face. What is it? Duh. What is he talking about? I am talking about the things that are seen, speaking about the things that are not seen. So make the connection. Say, I'm a child of Issachar. Yes, I understand the times. The name Donald means ruler of worlds. That should get you angry, though. Ruler of worlds. And the name Trump means victorious. Victorious ruler of worlds. As much as you may not have voted for him, his name is very prophetic in terms of being victorious when he should have lost. Well, 3 million is a lot. And he still win. Only in America, according to Don King, only in America. Can somebody get 3 million more than you and lose? Well, we who are from Guyana, we know that too. Barnum used to make the dead vote. Leave us alone. Name of Jesus. Come on now. Come back here. You got some of Forbes acolytes sitting right here. Just my mother used to go voting with a coconut oil bottle in her hip. And that purple stuff, you got to put your hand in there. So she'll duck her hand in the coconut oil and then duck it in the purple stuff. Then wipe it off, then go to the next polling station and vote. All day she would vote. 50, 60 times. Yeah, so don't let me expose more stuff now. Let's get on with this prophetic thing. Leave GT alone. Yes, Pharaoh chose Joseph, a godly man. Trump chose Pence, supposedly a godly man. From the crossroads state, America at the crossroads when a so-called godly man is chosen to help to balance the power. Are you hearing, brother? The Donald is the oldest president to be voted into office, age 70. He doesn't look it. He doesn't move like a 70-year-old. I wish I had his energy. Sometimes I look at him, I wonder, where does he get it from? He keeps moving and moving and going and going. And when you do meet him, for those of you who have met him, he's a likable guy. Yeah? See my page with me and the Donald. He's giving me the thumbs up. Very nice person. And when he speaks, he holds the crowd. He got you by the juggler. Until he's done, you can't move. He may not be saying much of substance, but you're thinking he's a billionaire. Eh? And the world likes rich people. I don't care what you say. So you're paying attention. Maybe he'll give you a check that will change your life. All joking aside, I was in the audience when he spoke, and I'm a speaker, and I'm telling you, he's good. On a scale of 1 to 10, he's a 9 plus. He's good. He can hold you. He can hold you. He can hold you. For 1 hour, he can hold you. Oldest man to be voted in as president, age 70. What does that tell you? God is not done with the senior citizens of the world. Donald is the sign, the visible sign of the invisible. Come on, make the connection. Don't be all over the place. Pay attention to a brother. I got about 10 more minutes. He's a sign of the first fruits. There will be an explosion among seniors who some will even go back to school and become more useful. This 60 and 70 something will make a great impact for kingdom advancement. Watch it happen. It's going to happen. They don't have grandchildren to mine and great grandchildren to take care of. They don't have a job. They are right now off the job. They're on pension. They are ready to go all over the place. They have the time and the wisdom to do things for God. Shout yes. Yes. Some people got it. Some still saying yes. Their latter years will be greater than their first. They will do more older than they did when they were young. They will do more at 68 than they did when they were 28. Sometimes I think youth is wasted on the young. All that energy and vigor, and they're wasting it on drugs and all this other stuff. I see some men come to church, the height and the bulk that they have. I said, I wish I had that size. Oh, what I wouldn't do. But I got this size, I'm going to work it. I'm going to behave like I'm 10 foot tall to the glory of God in the name of Jesus. Yes! On his inauguration, he was 70 years old, 7 months and 7 days. Here's that 777. You can't miss it. You got to be Ray Charles and Stevie Wonder to miss something as big a sign as this. And yet Christians, they're so biased. They're not paying attention to what God is doing. God called Nebuchadnezzar his servant. I read that thing. I got upset. I said, no. No. Man, God, man. Nebuchadnezzar, the rascal of all rascals. stole the gold from inside the church offering basket. You calling him your servant? God said, my servant whom I have raised up. I said, no. If he is a servant of God, I must be an angel. The heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord, and he turneth it whithersoever he will. Glory to God, man. Yes, I was saying he was 70 years old, 7 months and 7 days, on the day when he was inaugurated. In the Hebraic year, 5777, he won by 77 electoral votes. Come on, church, pay attention. See the invisible in the visible. Make the connection for God's sake. Don't be oblivious. Don't get your information from CNN, ABC, and Fox News. Suss it out, the Rasta man said. Are you still paying attention? Yes. He beat her by 77 electoral votes. 5, the number of grace. 7, completion, perfection, maturity. Trump 5777777. You don't want it more than that. He came from behind. No matter how bad you are losing, you can still win. That's the message in the whole election. Here's an unknown guy who's not skilled in politics, winning against a juggernaut of a Clinton.